Hello and welcome to this special edition of Dateline. I'm Yalda Hakim, coming to you live from Ground Zero here in New York on the 10th anniversary of the devastating attack that changed America and the world.
Tonight, the long shadow of the Twin Towers.
I think it's a loss of innocence, but I don't think it was a turning toward hatred.
10 years on from America's darkest day, we meet the 9/11 generation.
I felt an obligation to help my country, help my community. September 11th, I think, is really our Kennedy moment.
Well, it's early morning here, and it looks like it's going to be a cloudless day, just like the beautiful blue sky of 10 years ago, on that fateful morning, which became a defining moment for the early 21st century. Security is tight after what has been described as a credible threat of an Al-Qaeda attack, but crowds are already gathering below me. They're here to commemorate the 2,606 people who were killed when hijacked planes flew into the Twin Towers that once stood behind me. Hundreds more died in the two other terror attacks in Washington and Pennsylvania that September morning. The impact of that day has been far greater than anyone could have imagined at the time. It's affected the lives of millions worldwide. Shortly, we'll take you to Afghanistan, where hundreds of Australian soldiers are still fighting the so-called War on Terror.
Private Lambert initiated a pressure plate OAD, and subsequently he's now deceased as of this morning.
The longest war in Australia's history keeps on claiming lives. So when will its architects be able to claim victory?
All long wars are unpopular. By definition, the only popular war is one that's very short and one very convincingly.
What is the change that has happened in Iraq after the invasion?
And Walkley Award-winning journalist Fuad Hardy returns to his homeland to investigate Iraq's growing political culture and meets the brother of Iraq's most famous shoe thrower.
Well, we're just under 2 hours away from the moment when the first plane smashed into the North Tower of the World Trade Center, here in Lower Manhattan. Everywhere you go in New York, there are people still trying to come to terms with that wrenching, almost unthinkable moment. But, as Dateline's Aaron Lewis found, it's inspired some people to make the world a better place.
Usman Adnan grew up across the water from Lower Manhattan, in Middletown, New Jersey, the town that lost more lives in the September 11th attacks than any place outside the city itself.
This is Middletown. It's a great town. Absolutely fantastic town to have grown up in.
September 11th, I think, is really our Kennedy moment, and it impacted our generation the same way the Kennedy assassination affected our parents' generation.
Usman and Luke McCann have been close friends since they were young children. They grew up surfing with friends on the Jersey beaches.
It was a complete devastation. I mean, we've lost so many lives from just our town of Middletown. And whether it was friends or family that we all grieved over, we came together. And as tight as we are, it brought us closer. But I mean, even as being just across, I mean, you could see New York City skyline from here usually when there's a clear day. And that day there was some significant waves and we were all surfing and watching the towers burn and even watching the towers fall.
Looking back, Usman can see how that day changed his life.
9/11 affected me in many ways. I had a brother in the military. He signed up actually after 9/11 happened. I was in the military at that point. But it also just gave me a sense of purpose that, you know, I should try to do something to help my country and help my community feel safe.
Usman had struggled in school, but after September 11th, he found focus and decided to study international politics and law. Today, he's come to visit Patricia Corden, his vice principal, while at Middletown's high school.
Hi.
Usman, how are you?
How are you doing?
I am well. Come on in.
All right.
Come on in.
Come. Usman has good news for Patricia. He's passed his bar exam, and he's now a lawyer.
Do you have a particular area of law that you want to practice?
Patricia has watched Middletown's young people grow up in the shadow of the 9/11 tragedy. Even on that day, her first thoughts were for her students.
I remember telling the security guards to go through the school and make sure all the TVs were turned off, because we have so many parents who work in the city that I didn't want anybody to be watching TV and seeing this and thinking it could be their parent.
On that day 10 years ago, almost every street in Middletown experienced some kind of loss.
On my mom's street, Kenny next door died. I think a woman down the street, her twin brother was killed. There was someone else who was injured down the street. This is like a small little street. In the school that I was in, Lori's brother-in-law was a firefighter. He died doing what he wanted to do, help and save people.
I'm told that single day shaped an entire generation of this corner of small-town America.
I do believe that 9/11 did shape the lives of children, youngsters, teenagers, young adults who were old enough to understand the impact and the import of this. I think it was a loss of innocence, but I don't think it was a turning toward hatred.
Usman is a Pakistani-American and a Muslim. None of those distinctions had caused him any concern until the attack on the Twin Towers.
The weeks after September 11th, when you put on the TV and you'd see that anti-Muslim, anti-Islamic rhetoric by certain politicians or certain news organizations, you really were just flabbergasted. I was young. I was 18 years old, and I really didn't know what to think. Honestly, I was honestly afraid that, you know, I just didn't know what was going to happen.
Middletown is a commuter town. On September 11th, 2001, hundreds of commuters boarded the morning train. But many didn't make it home. The train station parking lot was scattered with abandoned cars for the first days afterward. Yet, while much of America became highly suspicious of Muslims, Usman found that in Middletown, everyone just grew closer together.
After September 11th, people were very generous. People were very compassionate towards my family and our security and how we felt. And they wanted to make sure we were okay.
You didn't feel that people were looking at you like the enemy?
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not.
Are you proud of that? Are you proud of the fact?
No, you know what? I'm very, very proud of my town and how responsible everyone was and how compassionate everybody was after September 11th.
I don't even know that day or that week if I ever thought that he was a Muslim. He was a person. I don't look at you and say that oh, I think you're Catholic, or you were Jewish, or you're an agnostic, or you're an atheist. It's, I live in America.
In fact, in the years since, the Muslim population in Middletown has thrived. On the last day of Ramadan, the celebration is so large that the local mosque cannot hold everyone. And so Middletown's imam, Rita Shatta, leads prayer at the community college.
We نجد أن المجتمع الأمريكي في ميدلتاون كان مجتمع حفي جدا بالجالية الإسلامية لأنها جالية متعاونة معه وجالية راسخة الجذور ومندمجة مع المجتمع ولذلك لم تحدث ولا حادثة واحدة ممكن أن نقول أنها حادثة تمييز عنصري أو اعتداء أو كذا بالعكس يعني وجدنا سواء كان من البوليس الأمريكي أو سواء كان من المجتمع الأمريكي الذي حولنا كل تعاون وكل إيجابي.
Yet even so, September 11th affected his community, especially the adolescent among them.
ففي نماذج من الشباب تأثرت تأثر إيجابي تفاعلت تفاعل طيب في ناحية أخرى شباب تأثروا تأثر سلبي بالعكس يجب أن يكون إيجابي ويجب أن يحاول أن يشرح رسالة الله إلى الناس وإنه يبين أن هذا التطرف وأن هذا الإرهاب وأن هذه القاعدة بعيدة من الإسلام أبعد مما بين السماء والأرض.
Usman takes me to the memorial for the victims of 9/11 that sits across from the train station. It's a moving, even haunting tribute to those that were lost.
I remember the faces of the people, and it's just hard. It's a very hard memory. But on the other hand, we should never, ever forget it. But remembering that day, I think, is very hard. It's very wearing. It's like any tragedy in your life. Do you dwell on that day, or do you dwell on the memories of the people of the day that make you happy with the memories?
Usman is now looking towards the future. He's finished his education and is about to strike out into a much changed world.
You know, I studied law and policy and foreign policy, and I traveled to different parts of the Muslim world and educated myself on culture and languages.
And what do you want to do with that?
Well, I want to contribute to policy debates. We can't sacrifice civil liberties for a false sense of security. We can't forget about human rights because that's what makes America, America.
I mean, the fact that Usman is doing something wonderful with his life, does it make a difference what his religion, what his ethnicity is? It may make a difference to him. It doesn't make a difference to me.
It's been years since Usman went to Ground Zero. And so we take the train from Middletown to Manhattan. After 10 long years, the Freedom Tower is finally rising from where the Twin Towers once stood.
Once that tower's finished and done, and all these cranes are gone, the sense of closure will be there, and I think we can all start to move on with it.
In a sense, you know, those attacks were meant to scare everyone. I mean, that's what the terrorists wanted to do. And they wanted to make everybody suspicious of one another. They wanted to separate this country. And to let them do that, let them frighten everyone, to let them not live their lives the way that people would have lived on September 10th, would let them win.
Thank you.
Karen Lewis reporting, and the Freedom Tower is rising up behind me. But America wasn't the only place to feel the impact of 9/11. Pretty soon, the shockwaves were being felt around the globe. One of the architects of America's response to the terror attacks was Richard Armitage. He was then Deputy Secretary of State. He famously threatened to bomb Pakistan back to the Stone Age if it didn't cooperate in the war on terror. I caught up with Richard Armitage in Washington and asked him what he remembers of that frantic day 10 years ago as Washington scrambled into action.
The day of 9/11, I spent the entire day in my department talking, in the Department of State, talking with the Vice President and the members of the various bureaucracies through video teleconference. The mood that day was, once we got our bearings and realized that the initial wave of attacks was over, was one of first revenge and then anger. And that was quickly replaced, I think, in a week's time or so by realization that to some extent we'd lost our innocence. It's hard, I know, for an American to talk about being innocent, but we had been protected by our two great oceans historically, and so this was a big jolt.
Where does America's biggest threat come from today? Is it still Islamic extremism?
I think our biggest threat now is a sort of a domestic one, whether we'll regain our footing, regain our confidence. That terrorism will be with us for a while, but the combination of good intelligence, good law enforcement, international efforts, and not a little bit of luck have led a lot of us to dodge many bullets, although both Australia and the United States, of course, have suffered. And I'm thinking of the Bali bombing when I mention Australia.
Do you think the administration got the balance right between civil liberties and national security?
Largely, yes. However, there are some questions which I'm uninformed that I have, such as the extent of wiretapping and things of this nature. But I think we weren't quick enough to lighten up on some of the restrictions on civil liberties that we initially put into place once we had a better understanding of our enemy. That much I'll say. But yeah, I think roughly got it right. But I think I'd have been a little quicker, I hope, to back off on some of the restrictions.
America, and Australia for that matter, are still at war. Iraq and Afghanistan seem a long way from becoming democratic, stable nations. Were the actions of the Bush administration ill-conceived?
For me, I look at the casualties, even now as a civilian, I look at the casualties in both Iraq and Afghanistan every day. And it's hard for me to be optimistic when I see about 4,500 Americans killed, 2,000 British, not a small number of Australians and other coalition members killed, not to mention the number of Iraqis. But I can say that there is a rudimentary, flawed democracy in Iraq. And I know this country's not going to be attacking their neighbors in the near future. So I guess I gave you a mixed answer, but it kind of leads me to say that it's too soon to tell on Iraq. The question of Afghanistan, in my view, we did exactly the right thing. And let me be the first to applaud President Obama for his heroic decision to go after Osama bin Laden and Abbottabad. But we took our eye off the ball, both in going to Iraq and latterly just not really bearing down on the problem. And so were they ill-conceived? Certainly the manner in which we invaded Iraq was shoddy. But I have to say I was not one who opposed the use of force. Along with Secretary Powell, we tried to avoid the war, but we didn't oppose the use of force.
Do you have any regrets?
Yeah, I've got a gazillion regrets, and they start with the manner in which we invaded Iraq. And not the fact of, but the manner of. And anyone who tells you they go through life without regrets is someone who doesn't have enough self-introspection to be fit for good company.
Richard Armitage reflecting on the 9/11 decade. Welcome back to our special 9/11 edition of Dateline, live from Ground Zero in New York. A mere 26 days after the attacks here, the US and its allies invaded Afghanistan. 10 years on, this longest of wars continues for the US and Australia. SBS Chief Political Correspondent Karen Middleton has closely followed the conflict. She's just published a book on the subject, titled An Unwinnable War. Karen's recently been on the front line with Australian troops as they battle the Taliban.
Thank you. A town of barbed wire and bombed out buildings. Where you watch who crosses your path. And the Australian-made Bushmaster is the safest way to travel. Welcome to Taran Kot, the capital of Oruzgan province, Australia's responsibility. We've come to Afghanistan to see what 10 years has done. On September 11, 2001, I was in the United States. The then Prime Minister John Howard was on an official visit. Witnessing America under attack affected him profoundly. He committed Australia to war.
We will help them. We will support actions they take to properly retaliate in relation to these acts of bastardry.
A decade on, he's backing his judgment.
What did you think you were committing to at that time?
Some kind of military involvement commensurate with the capacity of the Australian forces. I mean, I didn't really have in my mind what it would be, but I just knew that at some point there'd be American action and we were going to be part of it.
John Howard doesn't believe a better strategy sooner might have made a shorter war.
And we're dealing with long wars. It almost never end now. It's a different world. We no longer see war as armies rolling across borders and being repulsed. We see long drawn out military campaigns and all of them become unpopular. All long wars are unpopular. By definition, the only popular war is one that's very short and won very convincingly.
Do you think we've stayed too long in that case?
No, I don't think we've stayed too long. I think we have continued to make progress.
We're going to see what progress looks like, heading for patrol base Mirrorwise in the Chora Valley. It's 40 kilometres away, a short flight in a small helicopter, body armour compulsory. This province is a spectacle of dust and unforgiving peaks, with incongruous slashes of green. A few years ago, these bases in the Baluchi and Chora valleys didn't exist. The Australians say that their here at all is progress. We're going out on patrol to see what the soldiers see. We're supposed to be spaced apart, so if one person steps on something explosive, it only claims one victim. On our first patrol, I'm sticking close.
This is the bazaar in the town of Chora, and we've got a lot of kids around, which is a good sign, because while the children are here, there's every chance that there aren't IEDs around. Nobody's likely to open fire. They don't want to kill the kids.
Bluetooth.
For the violence, Afghan military leaders blame Pakistan. The Australians are more circumspect, mostly. But mentoring task force commander Lieutenant Colonel Chris Smith gives his views away.
There are certainly links between individuals in the Taliban on the other side of the border and here. I think they're important connections, and there's no doubt that it's certain... Am I talking outside my lane?
He's asking the public affairs officer sitting nearby.
I certainly have a view on it.
He thinks for a long time before constructing a more diplomatic answer.
Yep, all right, I'll tell you what my answer would be. I think there are linkages between the insurgency within Afghanistan and there are linkages between the insurgents within this province and on the other side of the border in Pakistan. But as I understand it, Pakistan are doing everything that they can in concert with their allies in order to deal with the insurgents on the other side of the border.
Hello? Hello. How are you?
I'm well.
The power relationships inside the border are a tangled web. Enemies become friends, and friends may not always be. The Coalition Forces Association with warlord and now newly appointed police chief Matiula Khan has raised some eyebrows. He runs a militia of 2,400 men. The coalition forces pay him for protection on the road to Kandahar. It's made him very rich. It complicates the already difficult relationship between the Afghan National Army and National Police.
The more that we can get those guys to work together, the better it'll be in the long run when we're out of here.
At Mirawise and nearby combat outpost Mashal, they live and work alongside the ANA, training and mentoring them to a timetable, hand over security by 2014 and go home. Mentoring's slow, but the Afghans are stepping up. There's some nervousness about the handover timetable, including from the ANA. Lieutenant Colonel Gul Aga commands the 2nd Kandak of the 4th Brigade. He's reflecting on the past decade and looking to an uncertain future. Further down the road, where the Chora and Baluchi valleys meet, combat outpost Mashal is where the Australians are training the ANA. Day and night.
The next one will be a green star cluster.
It was here at Mashal in May this year that an Afghan soldier shot dead an Australian. The mentoring task force was about to rotate. Privates Elliot Volla Volla and Jason Boom and Sapper Jacob Dooley were among those arriving.
Did that have any impact before you left home? In terms
yeah,
of
definitely, yeah.
We didn't know what to expect with the relationship between Australian forces and the ANA.
Yeah.
But when we got here, yeah, we did our best to build our relationship with them, like playing cricket and stuff like that.
Yeah,
having
apparently child. They like cricket a lot.
Yeah, yeah, bloody cricket mad.
Are they any good?
They beat us all the time.
Private Volla Volla says relations have improved.
When we try to mentor them on patrol, they sort of really didn't really maybe respect us, didn't listen to us sort of thing.
Yeah.
But over these last couple of months, we formed a pretty good friendship with them, and I think they listen to us a lot more now, and definitely respect us a lot more.
How did that happen? Do you feel like you're learning skills here that you'll take home and use in other ways? I mean, are you learning kind of life skills here? Like what? But what kinds of things would you put in?
Not taking shit for granted, I suppose.
Yeah.
Seeing these guys, they use every little thing. Like we've got everything, we've been given everything. So
yeah, that's interesting.
A good appreciation of what we actually got.
We talk about risk. When they first arrived, they were nervous on patrol.
Then we got a bit comfortable, and now so much it's not really drama. We just go out there and get the job done.
It's a lot. It's definitely a lot different to a normal job, and every now and again you think about the risk, but you just got to sort of, have faith in the guys around you and the equipment that you're given and that sort of stuff.
The next morning, risk becomes reality. It falls to Lieutenant Chris Thompson and Patrol Sergeant Justin Huggett to break the news that a colleague, Private Matthew Lambert, has been killed.
It pains me to tell you, but a tragic incident occurred the early hours this morning with B Squadron. We think they may have been in the Mirabad Valley. We haven't got full information on whereabouts they were. However, the sniper team attached to B Squadron were conducting a dismounted patrol and Private Lambert initiated a pressure plate OAD, and subsequently he's now deceased as of this morning. Right, so it's a harsh reality of the area we're operating in. But it's some things that are going to happen, and we've got to get used to it all. What I suggest you do is have a bit of downtime and just talk with each other.
Internet's down, phones are down. Okay, you know the standard procedure, all right? Don't. Lambo's quite well known in the battalion, all right? So let's give his family some time to deal with this as well.
They're given the rest of the day off until a ceremony at 4 o'clock, and the camp falls quiet. Warrant Officer Damien Timms is a trainer. He's been through this before.
The first time you go out, you cope with those sort of fears. And they certainly fears. But, yeah, and they'll come back to you at different times. But you just get used to it. It's like it becomes a normal sort of thing. It didn't get that crazy.
He says the Army's unfortunately becoming good at managing loss.
Hopefully this is the only one from now. Yeah, knock on wood.
We're leaving them with their grief, driven back to Tarin Kot as planned.
It's a pretty sombre ride back to TK this afternoon. These guys are driving us back, especially and escorting a fuel convoy as well. We've been talking about the possibility of these kinds of events over the last few days, and you go out on patrol and every single day you think about it, but the reality's really come home for these guys today. And the first death that they've suffered is mentoring Task Force 3. They've been here nearly 3 months and they haven't lost anyone, and so they're taking it pretty hard today.
Hours later, we get our own reminder of the risks. It's a rocket attack at the base. We are in the safest possible place, our accommodations reinforced steel. Happily, the rocket falls short and nobody's hurt. But the day's damage is already done, as mates would bear witness soon enough. The cruelty of random chance in a country a long time at war.
Karen Middleton reporting on a war that's increasingly unpopular, both in Australia and here. For another take on the conflict in Afghanistan, I spoke earlier with Michael Scheuer. He's a former CIA intelligence officer who spent many years leading the hunt for Osama bin Laden. His book, titled Imperial Hubris, was recommended by bin Laden himself. It's about why the West was losing the fight against Al-Qaeda. I asked Michael Scheuer whether invading Afghanistan had made the West safer.
It would have, had it been conducted in a manner appropriate to the country. A 12 or 15 month military action that destroyed as much of the Taliban and Al-Qaeda as we could, and then a quick withdrawal, knowing full well we might have to do it again. But what we've done is send not enough troops to do the job we decided to do, to build some kind of a democracy in a very conservative Muslim land, a very tribalized land. And so at the end of the day, we have not won. President Obama has thrown in the towel. We and the British have begun to withdraw troops. And the country is much more Islamic than it was when we started. So that rambling answer leads me to a no, we're not safer, because it's going to come back to being a Taliban-style government. But the Taliban now will have a much greater cachet in the Muslim world because they've defeated a superpower and its allies.
Was there an alternative to the West's response to the 9/11 attacks that could have been more effective?
Absolutely. We really needed to listen to the enemy and say, okay, here's the deal. This war is about our foreign policy, what we do in the Muslim world. And what we do there to this day may be absolutely necessary. to support the Saudi tyranny, to support the Israelis, to maintain the flow of oil. All of those things. These were not policies created by madmen or mad women. But it always has seemed to me that if you don't understand that those policies motivate your enemy, you're not going to know how to defend yourself. And I'm afraid that's where we are at the moment. We are killing people one at a time. And it's certainly worthwhile to do that. But after 10 years, what do we have? We have a body count. What do they have? They have a bigger organization, a bigger worldwide movement that they've inspired. They have the American military, the greatest power on earth, quitting two wars without winning. We have a debt that could rise to $4 trillion just for these wars. We have a constriction in civil liberties in our country. And we have now an increasing series of young American U.S. citizen Muslim males who are willing to attack their own countrymen at home. It's not a good balance. And a lot of it comes from not listening to what the enemy said. It's like us ignoring Mein Kampf in 1923.
So would you say the West has lost the war on terror?
We're losing a war that's rapidly becoming a civilizational war because we haven't listened. I am a hawk on most things. I'm not a leftist. I'm a very conservative person. But I really do think we need to look at our actions. Actions promote reactions. And to assume that the Muslim world simply misunderstands our good intentions vis-a-vis our policy is really an arrogant kind of attitude. That sounds like Kipling, doesn't it? It's the white man's burden to raise these people out of their superstitious religious morass to become more like us. Well, that's the path to war.
You have to wonder if those lessons have been learned. The rest of that interview is on our website. You'll find the full interviews with John Howard and Richard Armitage there as well. Welcome back. We're coming to you live from Ground Zero. And now to Iraq, another long conflict that characterized this past decade. It was a conflict which cost the US and its allies thousands of casualties and wreaked havoc on civilians. Saddam is gone, but it's not yet clear what sort of nation will emerge. Dateline's Fuad Hardy, an Iraqi Australian, has been back to Baghdad to ask one simple question. What do people think of their fledgling democracy?
The shock and awe bombing of Baghdad was a defining image of the war. So was the pulling down of Saddam's statue by US Marines.
President Bush regards this as an historic moment. The scenes on television show the thirst for freedom is unquenchable. That from the president.
Kate, I think he's absolutely right. You know, people love freedom. They can't get enough of it.
This is how the square looks today. Almost empty. But I find this man. His young niece needs an operation. He shows me her medical papers.
والله اطمح يعني الى من بغداد ولا ما الخدمات ويا الكهرباء والماء والتعيين يعني تتوفر.
There is not much I can do to help him. I wonder if this is all that freedom has delivered. I travel across town to the Shalal market. I hear the same story. People are angry.
والله كل خدمات ماكو لا كهرباء لا ماي لا انتقام الله لا كجمع كجمع لا شيء غير كلها بطالة شو باي قاعد العاب كلها بطالة
السلام عليكم شلونك يا غالي
حسب عدمي حسب I find this little boy
كيف تشتغل هسه؟
بيع ماي جاب الكل
بيع ماي كيف عمرك؟
كل الجوع
12 سنة ويا من عايش؟
ويا اختك الكبيرة
ويا اختك الكبيرة؟ وامك وابوك شلون ماتوا؟
موت الله
He won't say what happened to his parents. Since the war on sectarian violence, there are many orphans in Iraq. As I leave, I am stopped by these soldiers. I have to keep my camera low. Security has increased in Baghdad, but that hasn't stopped the Islamist bombers. This is my friend Bashir Al-Hadi. He wants to show me a recent attack.
قبل أيام هنا هذا المكان تعرض إلى تفجير هذا المكان كان بمحلات محلات متعددة يبيعون مشروبات كحولية عادة ما تتعرض محلات المشروبات إلى يعني تفجير لدواعي إسلامية لدواعي كثيرة ماكو جهة تعلن عن يعني أسباب التفجير
بشير takes me to where he used to live
على فكرة هذا الحي من الأحياء القديمة من المفترض أن تكون له عناية ويعني اهتمام لاحظ التراب هذا بقى لاحظ يعني ما ممكن يعني شلون يقدر إنسان يعيش بهاي الأجواء يعني هذا
This is what happens when the government can't deliver electricity.
الكل معتمد على هذه المولدات مقابل هاي المولدات هي أهلية درجة الحرارة الآن 54 درجة مئوية عندنا أطفال عندنا نساء عجائز رجال كبار بالسن مرضى يعني ما ممكن الحر لا يطاق ما ممكن واحد يعيش بدون كهرباء التزامه بتعويض الكهرباء يعني هسه بهاللحظة بهاللحظة شفت اجت الكهرباء الوطنية راح يطفي المولدة راح تشوف انه الكهرباء ما تستمر اكثر من ساعة فقط الوطنية ساعة ممكن كل ساعة بالساعة تطفى 6 مرات يعني هاي الساعة بعض الأحيان تجي هاي الوطنية ما تشغل مروحة بعض الأحيان تجي ما تشغل ما ممكن تستفاد من عندها
بشير takes me to what he calls his breathing space A space where artists and intellectuals meet. He says the freedom of speech is under threat.
يعني مو أي مكان تقدر تقعد يعني ظل هاي الظروف أصبحت الكلمة محسوبة عليك كإعلامي كلمتك محسوبة أصبحت المخاطر كثيرة يعني في بعض الأماكن.
ما يحدث الآن.
قاسم السبتي is a famous painter. He owns the gallery and coffee shop. He is worried by the increasing power of the religious parties in Iraq and the militias.
رؤوس الأموال الخطيرة موجودة عند الميليشيات اللي توظف وتأسس منظمات مجتمع مدني معنية بالخراب تأسيس الخراب. أما منظمات المجتمع المدني الحقيقية والمعنية بصنع الحياة لم يعني يتم مساعدتها صدقني بملاليم كما يقولون.
Despite this, he says there is hope in the new Iraq.
10 سنين على سبتمبر 11. سبتمبر 11.
نعم.
هل صبت في مصلحة الشعب العراقي نيجاتيف أو بوزيتيف؟
بوزيتيف على كل الأصعدة ونيجاتيف لقضية واحدة. وهي أنه هناك فسحة فعلا من الديمقراطية قد تكون هي ضعيفة إلى حد ما ولكنها تتأسس بخفر كما يقولون على خجل ولكن على الأقل هناك ضوء في نهاية النفق كما يقولون كان هذا الضوء ليس موجودا في السابق
ف But Bashir doesn't see any light. He was a presenter on a program called Chance for a Job on satellite TV. He was sacked after a demonstration where he criticized Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki.
الآن هسه إذا أريد أتعاقد ويا أي مؤسسة إعلامية يشترط أن لا أتكلم على فلان، يشترط أن لا أنتقد فلان، يشترط أن أستضيف فلان إذا كان في برنامج محدد أو معين أن أستضيف هذا الشخص، أن أحاول أن ما أضغط عليه بالأسئلة إذا كانت أسئلة مهمة. هناك أجندة.
14 دفتر مطين جو العبا الأمانة.
إيناس طارق also knows about restrictions in the new Iraq. She's a gutsy reporter for Al Mada newspaper. The local council wants this area redeveloped. They smash these shops. And the shop owners say the head of the council sent goons to throw them out.
وياي مشغل لي اربع عمال كل واحد مثل ما يقول عنده عائله وعنده اطفال وين يروحون.
Now the police arrive.
تصوير داخل السوق قناه اي بالسوق.
هاي الدوريه لازم تاخذ موافقه هي واحنا ندخل يعني اعلاميين احنا يعني هاي جزء انتم لان صحيفه اجنبيه خلونا ندخل. بس اذا احنا اعلاميين وعراقيين لا ما يخلونا ندخل.
ايش معاناتكم يعني؟
اي والله زي ما اخذنا للمركز. اي والله.
ليش هذا حجم الحقيقه؟
حتى ما يخلونا نطلع الحقيقه هي لان هم مشاركين بها هاي.
عفوا استاذ
حتى الديمقراطيه هم ما رايدينها اصلا. لان هم صارت بس فئات واحساب يعني القوي هو اللي ياخذ الضعيف هسه. يعني مثل هذا سوق مثل هذا مو صحيح؟ 134 شخص راح يشردون يا اما يكونون ارهابيه يا اما قتله يا اما يرجعون يسرقون البيوت على مود يقدرون يعيشون.
يعني هي هاي الحريه الموعوده الديمقراطيه؟
ماكو اي حريه يعني اي حريه هاي اللي المواطن اللي يعبر عنها ينضرب. يعني البارحه اللي هم ضاربيهم طلقات يعني انا تلاحظني باللقاء كله انه انا لابسه النظارات حتى لا حد يعني لا حد يميز شخصيتي هاي بالمستقبل او حد يشوفني مثلا ويا عائلتي او اكون فد هدف مثلا مستهدف لهم بدون يميزون شخصيتي. يعني لازم يكون فد نوع من التنكر خصوصا المراه هنا يعني. بس راح يدون يضربون.
I go with Inas to the center of Baghdad. We call this Tahrir Square. There is a demonstration here every Friday. It used to be large, but 11 people were killed by security forces in February. US troops are leaving Iraq, but these people say America still has too much power. This is Dirgham Al-Zaidi. His brother Muntadhar has a special place in Iraq's recent history. He was the shoe thrower. Dirgham shows me a poster of his brother. After being jailed in Baghdad, he now lives in Beirut. He is afraid to return.
وينسبوها الى غير جهات يعني هو احنا خايفين هذا الشيء الاعتقال هين لكن اذا اغتالوا وقالوا جهه الفلانيه وقالوا او حادث.
What happened to his brother and the trauma of his country's history has taken its toll.
مستعد اخسر روحي واخسر اطفالي واخسر عائلتي واخسر كل شيء بس الاراك يتحرر.
Like Iraq, Dirgham's future remains uncertain.
Fuad Hadi, doing what he does best, reporting from the streets of Baghdad. And on this 10th anniversary of the 9/11 attacks, go online for more background with our special interactive feature. It includes some striking photos of Ground Zero then, compared to how this area looks now. For continuing coverage of events here, don't forget SBS News Online. That's all at sbs.com.au/dateline.